I feel honoured to have served it, and I will do everything I can in future to help this great country succeed.
Good evening from a shell-shocked Westminster. David Cameron's premiership has ended after Remain lost the referendum he called to resolve his own party's civil war over Europe, which he himself said put at risk the national interest. The immediate economic and political consequences tonight are grave and the future deeply uncertain. But a majority of the country has voted for Britain to go it alone. But at least one of the Tory Brexiteer bidders to replace the Prime Minister has already emerged to a mixed reception.
I believe the British people have spoken up for democracy in Britain and across Europe. And I think we can be very proud of the result.
But in exercising the Europe question, particularly away from London, Cameron's referendum gamble has divided Britain, north from south, young from old, rich from poor, and ignited verbal warfare to render race and immigration the key.
It's all about immigration. It's to stop the Muslims from coming into this country. Simple as that.
They're coming in and probably taking from the NHS what they haven't actually paid into.
My parents, my grandparents, fought for England to be free. And it's about time we would come back.
The pound hit its lowest level since 1985, triggering fears of price rises and problems with pensions. The shock referendum result sent markets into a spin. And it wasn't only in London. The financial reverberations sent markets down in Paris, in Frankfurt and in New York.
And I'm live in Brussels, where the high priesthood of the EU is shocked, heartbroken and angry today. Angry because Britain has lit a fire in Europe. And the message from here is unequivocal. The divorce you want will be very costly.
Last night's vote imperils not only the EU, but a far older union too. Scotland's 300-year-old relationship with the United Kingdom. Scots who voted overwhelmingly to stay in the EU might get their wish if they can stomach quitting the UK, as the government here in Edinburgh says a second referendum on Scottish independence is highly likely.
The option of a second referendum must be on the table, and it is on the table.
The Leave campaign's victory has changed Britain's destiny. It has also dealt a body blow to the country's political establishment and destroyed David Cameron's premiership. He says he'll be gone by October and a new prime minister will negotiate the country's exit from the European Union. UKIP's leader Nigel Farage hailed the result as a victory for decent people and demanded a Brexit government. His triumphant declaration overshadowed that of Boris Johnson and Michael Gove. As the markets plunged, they attempted to calm the febrile mood, telling the millions who did not vote for Brexit that they were not pulling up the drawbridge. Our political editor, Gary Gibbon, watched how the day's events unfolded.
3 in the morning, Leave supporters realise they've actually won. Their hero, the man who helped to scare David Cameron into calling a referendum, was the first political leader to frame the result.
This, if the predictions now are right, this will be a victory for real people, a victory for ordinary people, a victory for decent people.
Nigel Farage had helped to inflict a massive blow on the political establishment.
We've got our country back.
And at 7 in front of Parliament, he said he wanted a scalp to go with it.
We now need a Brexit government. A government that gets on with the job. A government that begins the renegotiation of our trade relationship.
An hour later, he got his wish. David Cameron was re-elected in last year's general election with a majority, now swept away by the Brexit uprising.
The British people have made a very clear decision to take a different path. And as such, I think the country requires fresh leadership to take it in this direction. I will do everything I can as Prime Minister to steady the ship over the coming weeks and months. But I do not think it would be right for me to try to be the captain that steers our country to its next destination. This is not a decision I've taken lightly, but I do believe it's in the national interest to have a period of stability and then the new leadership required. There is no need for a precise timetable today, but in my view, we should aim to have a new Prime Minister in place by the start of the Conservative Party conference in October.
Some senior Tories said that would mean 3 months of zombie government, and they want him out much quicker. His wife looked tearful. His voice trembled.
I love this country, and I feel honoured to have served it. And I will do everything I can in future to help this great country succeed. Thank you very much.
The country had now lost its Prime Minister, as well as a central long-standing strategic commitment. The pound plunged, shares too. So all eyes were on the leaders of the official Leave campaign to fill a massive political vacuum. Boris Johnson left his home to boos and insults from passing North Londoners. Residents of the only part of England to back Remain. 8 hours after their first celebrations, the victors, determined to look sombre, were almost funereal. They said there was no need for haste in negotiations with Brussels. Their victory would bring a brighter future.
To those who may be anxious, whether at home or abroad, this does not mean that the United Kingdom will be in any way less united, nor indeed does it mean that it will be any less European. And I want to speak to the millions of people, directly to the millions of people who did not vote for this outcome, especially young people who may feel that this decision in some way involves pulling up a drawbridge or any kind of isolationism. Because I think the very opposite is true. We cannot turn our backs on Europe. We are part of Europe. I believe we now have a glorious opportunity. We can pass our laws and set our taxes entirely according to the needs of the UK economy. We can control our own borders in a way that is not discriminatory, but fair and balanced, and take the wind out of the sails of the extremists and those who would play politics with immigration.
In Barnsley, nearly 70% voted for Boris Johnson's side, but his supporters here seem to think they're on some kind of a promise.
It's all about immigration, right? It's not about trade or Europe or anything like that. It's all about immigration. It's to stop the Muslims from coming into this country. Simple as that.
Foreigners, get them out, kick them all out.
Sheffield was a narrow win for Leave, leaving the Remain voters deeply unnerved.
It's shameful. I'm ashamed to be British right now.
Little Englanders.
Are you angry?
I am.
Those who wanted severely restricted immigration could be very disappointed by whoever is our next Prime Minister. But the victory for Brexit is already having impact way beyond the issue that provoked it.
Well, now, this series of declarations from around the country throughout the night were reminiscent of a general election, and as each came in, the picture became clearer. The final numbers, then. 51.9% for Leave, 48.1% for Remain. Close, yes, but with a turnout at 72%, Leave won by more than a million votes. But the polls show a deeply divided country. In Scotland, every region supported continued EU membership. But in England, support for Leave was highest at over 53%. Time and again, regional England voted for Brexit. In the North East, 58% of people voted to leave. In the West Midlands, it was almost 60. The only English region backing continued EU membership was London, with almost 60% support. But who voted and what motivated them? One poll of 12,000 people found big splits in age groups, with 73% of under-24s supporting Remain, compared with 60% Brexit support among pensioners. Better-off voters tended to vote Remain, whilst it was poorer, more disadvantaged voters who tended to vote Leave. The same survey asked voters if they see multiculturalism, immigration and social liberalism as forces for ill. Among those who agreed, 80% were Leave voters. And in the last few minutes, the US President Barack Obama has been speaking about the vote and the special relationship.
While the UK's relationship with the EU will change, one thing that will not change is the special relationship that exists between our two nations. That will endure.
Well, our political editor, Gary Gibbon, joins us again now. Gary, how big a moment is this? Place it in history.
Well, I think when the resignation of the Prime Minister is the second item on the news, you know you're in very big territory. I think you have to go quite a way back in history to find a moment when a central strategic relationship or goal of a Prime Minister, of a nation, crumbled in a Prime Minister's hands like this. I think you're talking Anthony Eden, Neville Chamberlain, in terms of trying to compare it with a career that has ended in such failure. This is what political failure looks like. And it's massive, of course, in terms of what it's going to mean, the work that's going to be endured in terms of building a new relationship with Europe and unpicking the one that's there. You've talked about America. There are implications for America, potentially. There are clearly implications for Scotland. And then there are the economic implications. What's the impact of all of this? At the moment, it would appear that the experts who were disparaged during this referendum and made a few predictions about the short-term economic impact seem to be on the money.
Forgive me, who's in charge tonight?
That is a pretty tricky one to put your finger on, because we glimpsed the Prime Minister today in that very emotional statement when he said he was leaving. The Chancellor, and there has been an awful lot of activity in the economy today that would normally mean you see the Chancellor, the Chancellor's restricted himself to the odd tweet. The people who are nominally in charge around the corner there are actually not in charge of this country, and there is pressure building amongst the people who won this referendum, Leave figures, ex-cabinet ministers and others, to get that team out earlier than the October deadline that David Cameron talked about. They're talking about this being a zombie administration. The language as charming as ever, but the intent, I think, quite menacing.
Gary Gibbon, thank you. The city, which last night had bet heavily on a Remain victory, was thrown into sudden reverse this morning, sending the pound and shares plummeting as billions were wiped off company values and personal pensions. And the cost of those Mediterranean holidays soared. The governor of the Bank of England, Mark Carney, emerged to try to soothe the markets, promising that contingency plans had been drawn up. Our business editor, Siobhan Kennedy, has this report.
This wasn't supposed to happen. The markets had decided the UK would vote Remain. But as dawn broke, it was a different story. Traders yelled in panic as the shock of Brexit hit, triggering unprecedented market turmoil.
This city has woken up to a profoundly different world than was expected this time yesterday. As you can see from the frenzied reaction of these traders here all around me, we know that sterling has tanked to a 30-year low, the euro has plummeted, markets are reeling. And here, just minutes ago, when the FTSE 100 share index opened up, it lost at one point some 8% of its value. That's about £140 billion wiped off stocks.
Bank shares were hit hardest, with Lloyds and RBS losing almost a third of their value. House builders saw similar dramatic falls. But the bloodbath was worldwide, with Japan's Nikkei down nearly 8% and German shares falling 10% at the opening. With the Prime Minister gone, it fell to a pensive-looking governor to try and calm the markets.
We are well prepared for this. The Bank of England stands ready to provide more than £250 billion of additional funds through its normal market operations.
As the market continues to absorb the numerous shocks here today, of course, it's the words of George Osborne that will be ringing in the traders' ears here. It was him who said that a vote for Brexit would lead to an emergency budget, to more austerity, and to an inevitable recession. So is that where the UK is headed?
The CBI boss fought tooth and nail for the Remain camp, but now says recession isn't a given.
We must not talk ourselves into this, that, as I say, we've got these deep trading relationships. We will have a period of uncertainty, but business is resilient. You know, it's been through change before. It will go through this again. I feel heartbroken.
If new trade deals can be negotiated swiftly, people shouldn't be worried about a downturn, the Brexit campaigner John Mills told me.
We're hearing anecdotally people that are having their mortgage application rejected this morning. There will be a knock-on effect for people, for their savings, for their own personal finances. Do you feel responsible for that?
Well, I think that you always get these sort of reactions, but actually, if you look at what happens after these sort of crises, very frequently these sort of things reverse themselves and you do not find yourself in the same sort of problems that you've just described.
He may be optimistic, but if the consumer fears a recession is looming, if they're worried about the price of their house falling and their pensions and savings losing value, then over time the danger is that they begin to curb their spending. And that in turn could bring about the very recession that they fear. Jessica Light says she's feeling the Brexit effect already. She sells her textiles across Europe, but is now worried for the future.
Well, the first email I opened this morning was one from one of my suppliers who said that because of the fluctuation in the pound at the moment, because of the uncertainty, they couldn't now guarantee the prices of the materials that I use. If this uncertainty goes on for 6 months, a year, my business is too small to sustain something like that, and I could go out of business.
Tonight, the immediate panic has subsided. The FTSE regained some of its value. But with so many questions left unanswered, there'll be very real fear about what happens next.
Siobhan Kennedy reporting. Well, our business and economics correspondent, Helia Ebrahimi, is with me now. So, internationally, how bad is it? Is it just a blip?
Well, look, if you took a snapshot of the markets tonight, you'd see that the FTSE 100 actually ended much more modestly, down about 2.7%. But Germany, France, Italy, they fared much worse. And in many ways, Brexit is going to and will continue to pose a bigger threat to Europe than it does to our home markets. And you could start to see the types of volatility you saw with the Greek bailout with European stability.
What about the situation right here?
Well, look, Mark Carney spent the day trying to assure the markets that the Bank of England would do everything to make sure stability happened. But let me tell you two things. While the FTSE 100 recovered nicely, the FTSE 250, which has smaller UK-based companies, had its worst day on record. That's a much better barometer of the future of UK economy. And the other thing, European banks, again, its worst day on record, worse even than the heart of the financial crisis.
It was the collapse of Lehman Brothers that triggered the last great disastrous crash. Is this a Lehman's moment?
I think people are worried not just because the roller coaster ride in the markets that we've seen. They're worried, is this the first of the chapter of beginning of other things? Is this the end of a UK where they can invest based on a stable government, you know, predictable legal system, a base that they can trade with Europe on, and a free labour force? Well, all of those things are up in the air, and people I spoke to were very wary. And it's not just the markets, because if you're looking at your pension funds, you've seen gilts be crushed. So I think we've got a real risk of, will it be a technical recession or could it be much, much worse?
Helia Ebrahimi. Now, if the economic landscape has been changed beyond recognition, then so too has British politics. We're now guaranteed a Conservative leadership election with a Prime Minister chosen by 120,000 party members. Labour could stage their own anti-Corbyn coup. And we could have another general election before the end of the year. Our political correspondent Michael Crick looks at the prospects.
A brace of leadership ballots, then a general election. That could be the menu for the rest of 2016, with one obvious favourite for next Prime Minister, the clamour led by his Remain-backing dad.
Boris managed to get 17,410,762 people to vote for him. It was an amazing achievement. If I was, you know, an MP trying to select a potential candidate, I would take that into consideration.
I think there are three great candidates. One is Boris, one is Michael, and the third is Andrea. The three Brexiteers, and any one of them would make a great leader of the party.
Michael Gove and Andrea Leadsom, he means, but Theresa May might well disagree if the Home Secretary was actually around. So here's her Commons aide, Michael Ellis, instead.
What's happened to her? I mean, she's been very, very quiet. Some might say opportunistically quiet.
Well, the Home Office is an extremely busy department.
Others, quite happily, seem to rule themselves out.
Are you a candidate for the leader? Would you like to rule yourself out?
I have given no thought at all to who I'm going to back for the leadership campaign.
So you're going to back somebody else. Mr. Fallon, are you a candidate for the leadership of your party?
No, I'm not a candidate.
You're not a candidate. Who is Villas? Will you be standing for the leadership of your party?
Definitely not.
I mean, if you want to throw your hat in the ring here and now, then no.
I gave up wearing a hat a long time ago.
Other maybes, the Pension Secretary Stephen Crabb and at Education, Nikki Morgan.
All I would say is I hope very much that there is a woman in the final two. Whether it's me or another colleague, I think that would be a great thing for the 21st century Conservative Party.
As for George Osborne, his hopes probably sank with David Cameron. But don't bank on Boris Johnson. The favourite has lost all nine Tory leadership polls in the last 60 years. Meanwhile, Labour could face a leadership election too. On Monday night at the Parliamentary Labour Party, two backbenchers have put down a motion of no confidence in Jeremy Corbyn. If it's passed, there'll be a secret ballot of MPs the following day, and goodness knows where that will lead. His critics know this is probably the best chance to oust Corbyn they'll get.
At the moment, Michael, based on the result of yesterday, he is not demonstrating he has the reach to win a general election. And if he can't do that, he can't have my support.
So you would vote against him on Monday and in the secret ballot on Tuesday?
I will be deciding what I do on the outcome of what he says on Monday. But I think what I think is important in all of this is we have a real honest discussion about what went wrong.
But the big unions backed Corbyn tonight, and he'll probably have the support of Labour members ahead of a general election, which the new Prime Minister might well call this autumn.
Yes, there could be a general election when the new leader of the Conservative Party is established. He or she might do what Gordon Brown didn't do and get a mandate of their own.
We're up for a general election whenever it comes.
You're up for a general election? You've got all the money? You've got the party geared up?
Well, we'll prepare. We'll do our usual. We'll raise the funds. We'll make sure we're geared up. Look, we want to get rid of this government, whichever leader is there, and sooner the better.
But you've lost all those working class voters last night in the north of England, in Wales, even in parts of London. You're going to lose seats if there's an election.
We lost the vote on reform, remain and reform, the policy we put forward. That doesn't necessarily translate into them not supporting the vast range of other policies that we're campaigning upon. But we're always up for an election to get rid of a Tory government.
Bring it on, you're saying?
Yeah, if that's what they want to do, we're up for it.
But some MPs even think losing a snap election would at least force Corbyn out.
Michael Crick. Well, now, a little earlier, I spoke with the Labour leader, Jeremy Corbyn. I began by asking if he had put his full weight behind the Remain campaign.
I travelled the length and breadth of this country. I did meetings in every major city. I did no end of factory meetings, college meetings, university meetings, and I did put the case across. At the end of the day, the majority of Labour voters voted to remain. The vast majority of Conservative voters voted to leave. I'm not happy with that situation, but we've got to reach out to everybody. We've got to reach out to those communities that feel let down by Britain, let down by Europe, and feel, frankly, they've been ignored ever since the destruction of the heavy industries by Margaret Thatcher's government in the 80s.
Well, much of that alienation is centred right here on Westminster, and you are of Westminster. You made your plea. You, like David Cameron, failed. He's resigning. Are you?
No. I'm carrying on. I'm making the case for unity. I'm making the case of what Labour can offer to Britain, of decent housing for people, of good, secure jobs for people, of trade with Europe and indeed, of course, with other parts of the world. Because if we don't get the trade issue right, we've got a real problem in this country. Already, since the Leave vote, there have been financial problems and they're probably going to get considerably worse. We need to have a government that doesn't heap yet more austerity on the poorest people in this country, a government that is prepared to intervene to protect jobs and industry.
Well, the inevitable consequence of today with a resigned Prime Minister is that there will be a new Prime Minister, presumably not of his particular outlook, but somebody more sceptical of Europe. The question then is, should there be a general election? Are you calling for a general election?
I think the issue will come up after the election of the new Tory leader. They may well decide to call an election. That will be...
Yeah, but are you pressing for one? I mean, shouldn't the British people...
What the British people need now is stability. Is stability to retain those jobs, stability to protect those working conditions, and we need a plan from this government now on how they're going to approach the negotiations for leaving the European Union before they invoke Article 50.
Your party is split most divisively over you. it is perfectly clear that the majority of Labour MPs want to get rid of you, and they say so. And who's done so today? Margaret Hodge, formerly a very prestigious MP in the House of Commons. And she's called for a vote of confidence in you later this year.
Margaret obviously is entitled to do what she wishes to do.
But it symbolises the problem, doesn't it?
I would ask her to think for a moment. Just think for a moment. A Tory Prime Minister resigned. Britain has voted to leave the European Union. There are massive political issues to be addressed. Is it really a good idea to start a big debate in the Labour Party when I was elected less than a year ago with a very large mandate?
Do you really ever want to be Prime Minister? I mean, with the appalling burdens that it inflicts upon you and your way of life.
The burdens it inflicts on people who suffer under this government or any other government that doesn't provide the housing people need, that doesn't provide the schools they need, that doesn't provide the hope they need, is far worse. Of course, I want to lead this party. I want to lead this party in order to put forward an alternative and lead this party to win the election.
I haven't heard the phrase, I want to be Prime Minister.
Well, you've just heard it now. Of course I want to be.
No, no, say it.
I've just said it to you, OK?
I want to be Prime Minister.
No, I've just said it to you, please. This isn't a school game.
No, no, but I have asked you that question.
I've answered the question. I'm leading this party to win an election, and therefore I'll be Prime Minister to do that. Thank you.
Jeremy Corbyn speaking to me earlier. Well, in a moment, I will be speaking with the Northern Ireland Secretary and Leave campaigner, Theresa Villiers. And there have been political ramifications on her patch today after the majority of people there voted for Remain. The Sinn Féin Deputy First Minister of Northern Ireland, Martin McGuinness, said the British government has no democratic mandate to represent the views of the North with the EU and called for a referendum on a united Ireland.
This is an unacceptable situation for us to find ourselves in against the backdrop of a vote which was in favour of Remain in the North, and for us to be dragged out of the European Union against our will is absolutely unacceptable.
So to the Northern Ireland Secretary, Theresa Villiers. Theresa Villiers, no prospect of a referendum in Northern Ireland on a united Ireland?
No, the circumstances in which such a referendum would be required are set out in the Good Friday Agreement. And that's where I, as Secretary of State, come to the conclusion that it would be a reasonable chance that there would be a majority for a united Ireland. And all the research and polls and information published over recent months and years have demonstrated strong support for the Good Friday Agreement and the political settlement, which of course locates Northern Ireland in the United Kingdom.
Nevertheless, you recognise you've thrown a spanner into the whole prospect of the United Kingdom remaining united and Northern Ireland too. Are you going to have a referendum in Northern Ireland if the Scottish National Party demand one?
I do not see that there's a justification for a referendum in Northern Ireland. I don't think there's a case...
In Scotland, I was asking. Scotland.
Well, like Ruth Davidson of the Scottish Conservatives, I think this would be the wrong time for such a referendum. We need political stability.
But you recognise the whole of Scotland has voted to remain.
The reality is that Scotland voted to stay a member of the United Kingdom at a time when it knew perfectly well that there would be a referendum on European Union membership.
It's now voted to remain a member of the European Union. They surely have the right to do so.
And the United Kingdom is currently the member of the European Union. We vote as a United Kingdom. I think the key here is that we need to understand the concerns of those who voted Remain and make it absolutely clear that we want to address those concerns by emphasising that we will have successful trade relations with the EU. We will deliver an outward-looking, liberal vision of the United Kingdom outside of the European Union.
Surely the key thing here is you've been prepared to play fast and loose with the prospects, the political prospects, of a United Kingdom. You now have an angry Scotland determined to ask this question again. You have an angry Northern Ireland that now wants to think about a united Ireland. This is devastating, and this is a risk you knew you were taking when you called this referendum. You knew it. You personally knew it.
In Northern Ireland, there were thousands of people who voted to leave, including the First Minister of Northern Ireland, who only recently won an assembly election there with a striking personal mandate. I think it was an entirely reasonable decision on my part to campaign for a leave vote. Yes, there was a majority in Northern Ireland for Remain, but the way we deal with that is to provide reassurance that we're going to deliver prosperity through our Brexit negotiations.
Okay.
Northern Ireland is going to flourish like the rest of the United Kingdom outside of the EU.
You, in common with everyone else, will know that the real issue that became the issue of this entire referendum was immigration. Now, Are you going to stop immigration? Are you going to drive the numbers down? And in which case, how and to what level?
Well, obviously, as I'm a Conservative elected on a manifesto to bring down immigration to the tens of thousands.
Which you failed to do.
That's one thing I want to deliver on. I believe that we do need changes to the way our immigration rules work.
What are those changes?
My colleagues in the Vote Leave campaign put forward ideas for a points-based system. What we need is a system which enables us to control the numbers, but also bring in the best and the brightest from around the world.
And what are those systems?
My colleagues have set them out.
You've been in government now for 10 years. You could easily have done, or 6 years rather, you've been in government. You've done nothing to change the numbers. Indeed, they've got higher.
Well, that was one of the points of having this referendum to give back to the government.
Yeah, but there's no point if you haven't got an answer to that question,
is there? Back to the government the right to set the rules on immigration from Europe.
Yeah, but you've had the right. You've had the right, and you've been bringing in more immigrants, in fact, from outside the European Union than from inside. What are you going to do about it? How's it going to work?
Well, one of the changes we're proposing to make is reform of human rights law. That will be an important part of the way
we
deal.
Tear up the Human Rights Act.
Reform of human rights law is in our manifesto.
Tear up the Human Rights
Act. That's what we will press ahead with. But absolutely, changes to free movement aren't the panacea on reducing immigration. There are a whole range of methods, which my colleagues in the Home Office are working on hard.
Sadly, we must end it there, but thank you very much indeed for coming along. So, how has all this gone down in Europe itself? Matt is in Brussels tonight. Matt?
Well, John, there was no shortage of red eyes and ashen pale faces here this morning. I've never seen anything like it in all the time that I've come here to Brussels, because make no mistake, John, history has been made. But for the people in the building behind me, it is the wrong kind of history. Here's the problem. In Europe, insurrections, revolutions tend to travel in packs, 1848, 1989. And there's a real fear in Brussels, in Paris, in Berlin, that this will be a domino effect, that there will be referendum fever across Europe, and that the rise of populist parties, especially on the right, will be massively boosted by what has just happened in Britain. Now, that's why everyone I've spoken to here today has said there can be no period of uncertainty. We cannot wait for 2 or 3 months or even 2 years before we start the negotiations of divorce. Those negotiations to say goodbye to Britain finally have to start possibly next week, as I found out. In the cold light of dawn, behind their inscrutable facade, the high priests of Europe digested the news from the troublesome island. Their flags fluttered without luster, and they confronted the worst crisis in their history. You really feel a stomach-churning sense of shock here, that the ground has shifted underneath people's feet, that nothing will ever quite be the same again here in Brussels. With chaos unfolding on the markets, the tone was a mixture of soul-searching and self-preservation with a soupçon of revenge.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. The member states who remain in the European Union must discuss how to improve the European Union and how to protect, especially the Eurozone countries, how to protect the Eurozone in the next coming month, to protect against what is happening already now with the pound, what is already happening on the international markets.
In the muffled corridors of power, there were post-mortem huddles galore, and this from a Polish MEP about the million Poles living and working in the UK.
The best have left to come to United Kingdom. So recovering or getting back the best, it's only our gain and your loss.
What's your general feeling about the way Britain voted yesterday?
First, we respect. Second, we regret. Third, we wish all the best luck alone. And we'll see, but do not expect that United Kingdom will get any privileged treatment from European Union of 27.
Yes.
Next time, don't count on Polish.
His parting shot, also don't expect Polish airmen to come to the help of Britain ever again.
My father was soldier on your side for 5 years.
So you feel personally betrayed then?
Yes. Yes. Yes.
You are angry?
Yes.
Britain has become toxic, and everyone here is in a hurry to speed up the divorce. Roberto Gualtieri will lead negotiations with the UK, wants them to start now, and reminded me of the cost of continued access to the single market.
Probably those who campaign for leaving forget to explain people that
the cost for this success with being out would be even higher than the cost being in. That's why I think it would have been far more rational a choice for remaining. But now what is done is done, of course.
One is saying A, another is saying B.
Upstairs, another EU leader and former Belgian Prime Minister was tweeting that Britain's economy had lost more money in the 8 hours after the result than in 15 years of contributions to the EU budget.
Boris Johnson has indicated that he might not invoke Article 50, which calls for the separation, until possibly 2018. Two years from now.
That's completely crazy, and it's against the will.
It's
against the will of the British citizens, because the British citizens have decided to leave. And then you have, first of all, David Cameron saying, I'm going to do nothing at all within 3 months. I wait for a new leadership and a possible new leadership. Boris Johnson is saying, I'm going to wait even longer than that. We cannot wait a new cockfight inside the Tory party on this.
Britain has lit a fire under Europe, and in Berlin too, they fear the pitchforks of popular anger.
Es gibt nichts drumherum zu reden.
There is no point beating about the bush. Today represents a break in Europe's history, a break in the process of European integration.
In Paris, François Hollande sounded both somber and punitive.
La Grande-Bretagne ne fera donc plus partie de l'Union européenne.
Great Britain won't be a part of the European Union anymore, and procedures that are laid down in treaties will be quickly applied. That is the rule, and that is the consequence.
C'est la règle, et c'est la conséquence.
Enough from the politicians. What about the ordinary people of Brussels?
Who's to blame? Is Britain to blame or the European Union to blame?
It's the politicians to blame, I think. I don't know. It's too complicated. I don't want to talk about it.
Is there any point in having a European Union?
I think so, yeah.
But you're not happy with it?
Not happy with the one we have today, no.
I hope that Scotland and Ireland and London will get independence for the rest of the United Kingdom.
London as well?
Yes, as well.
The independent city-state of London?
Yes, yes, I would like that.
Qu'est-ce que vous croyez?
C'est la vie.
C'est la vie?
I've always wondered who this statue outside the Commission represents. Now I know. All of us. Out or in. Here or there. Matt Fry, Channel 4 News, Brussels.
Well, if the ramifications of last night's vote are serious in Europe, they're equally profound here in Scotland. Many people I've been speaking to here in Edinburgh are genuinely shocked, sad, and really quite angry. Every region of Scotland voted to stay in the European Union. 62% of Scots backed Remain, and the First Minister Nicola Sturgeon said it would be democratically unacceptable for the nation to be taken out of the EU against its will. So will voters here opt to break from the UK in order to stick with the EU? Ms Sturgeon said a second referendum on Scottish independence is now highly likely. Here's our chief correspondent, Alex Thompson.
Voters throughout the UK have voted to leave the EU, but in Scotland it's a clean sweep for Remain.
Some sweep. 32 of 32 council areas voted Remain. 62% in Europe, 38% out overall. So for the ruling SNP, as promised in these circumstances, a second independence referendum now on agenda.
Scotland does now face that prospect. It is a significant and material change in circumstances, and it is therefore a statement of the obvious that the option of a second referendum must be on the table, and it is on the table.
Opposition leader Ruth Davidson soon countered, Scotland needs stability, she said, above all else.
But I do not believe that a second independence referendum will help us achieve that stability, nor this is in the best interests of the people of Scotland.
In the capital, as across the nation this morning, they were processing an overnight political earthquake.
It's quite a shock, shocking. I think this brings into pretty sharp focus the question of Scotland's constitutional future.
I think it's really gutting, but what can you do? I think we've let this generation down.
A song came to mind this morning. I'm leaving on a jet plane, don't know when I'll be back again. It's a bit like that, I think. Bye.
The Ayrshire coast today, and a parallel universe from Edinburgh's stark new realities. Hail to the would-be chief. Here to reopen Turnberry, his revamped golf resort, Donald Trump, the ultimate beneficiary of the protest vote.
Right. Basically, they took back their country. That's a great thing.
New balls available.
Then a carefully managed press conference, interrupted before it began. A protester unleashing golf balls with Nazi swastikas on them.
But Trump has now landed in the middle of a major news event here in the UK.
And he's come into political chaos.
True, out here at the famous ninth hole, he was geographically challenged for a moment.
And the lighthouse, which is a very, very important building in Florida, Scotland.
But he didn't miss a beat, soon crowing over a cowed Prime Minister.
Where's David Cameron right now?
The First Minister.
David Cameron. No, excuse me.
Alex Salmond said
David Cameron would have met me. David Cameron was negotiating to meet me. But right now, I don't think David Cameron wants to meet anybody.
But what about the EU? Quick message to the EU, sir. What's your message? I don't think anyone's asked you this. Your message to the EU today?
Well, we wish him luck.
With what, sir?
I just wish him a lot of luck.
And that was that. A few hours in a Scotland now left with a whole new political agenda by their English neighbours, dramatically tearing up the status quo. Alex Thompson, Channel 4 News, Turnberry.
Well, earlier I caught up with John Swinney, the Deputy First Minister of Scotland. I asked him whether Scotland should respect the majority vote of the whole of the UK instead of seeking a second referendum on independence.
Well, we've got a situation in Scotland today where we've had a very substantial vote to protect and maintain our membership of the European Union, and that's at odds with the position in the rest of the United Kingdom. But one of the key points that we were promised in the referendum on Scottish independence a couple of years ago was that if we remain part of the UK, that guaranteed our membership of the European Union. Well, that's just been questioned, destroyed today by the result that's come out in the early hours of this morning. So we've got a duty as a government in Scotland to protect the membership of the European Union that people in Scotland asked us to protect, and that's what we're going to do.
You're clearly going to make a big effort to persuade voters here to back a new independence referendum, but what about the Scottish and Labour parties here who are currently opposed to a second independence referendum?
I think people in our political parties have got to look at the circumstances that we now face, and they've also got a duty to face up to the realities and the consequences of their own position. They were part of an argument 2 years ago that said to the people of Scotland, vote no and you'll be guaranteed your membership of the European Union. Well, where are we today? That's been jeopardised by the result that's taken place.
Can you persuade the Conservatives and Labour to come around to your way of
thinking? Well, they'll have to think for themselves about this point, but the crucial point is that the people of this country, 62% of the people of Scotland, have voted to maintain Scotland's membership of the European Union, and the Scottish Government will pursue that and pursue it with all energy to secure that outcome.
Hasn't the financial case for an independent Scotland been shattered by plummeting oil prices?
Well, we've already been seeing a recovery in the oil price. The oil price has obviously faced difficulties.
You're way down.
Well, but it's faced it. There's been global challenges about the oil price right across the board, and we've seen growth and strengthening in the oil price. Of course, what we've seen as a consequence of the decision overnight is an erosion and deterioration of that oil price, and we'll also see other economic consequences as a result of the decisions that have been taken. So we'll look carefully at all of these arguments as we discuss and debate the issues around Scottish independence with the people of Scotland. But the crucial point, the thing that is driving our response to the referendum result last night, is the determination to enact the mandate of the people of Scotland to protect Scotland's membership of the European Union.
In a word, is an independence referendum winnable?
I think it is winnable. I think the people of Scotland will have been shocked by the fact that a solemn commitment given to them in the referendum in 2014 has been breached in the referendum yesterday. And that will give people in Scotland pause for thought about what is the future of our country.
John Swinney talking to Cathy in Edinburgh. Well, now back here in Westminster, where the overwhelming majority of MPs backed the Remain campaign, they're still trying to work out how they ended up so much at odds with those who elected them. Our social affairs editor, Jackie Long, has been to Romford. That's a town on the eastern edge of London where most people voted for Brexit.
It looks like life as usual, but something has fundamentally changed. Change that for many has been a long time in the making. David Crosbie's family have been in the fish trade for generations. He says the EU nearly destroyed them. He couldn't be happier.
So you pleased?
Yeah, well pleased. All my family voted leave. I'm a fishmonger, so I'm going to vote leave because they decimated it, the fishing industry. So now perhaps we can get a bit of our fishing industry back.
But this is about much more than fishing.
This is one of only five London boroughs to vote leave. On the outer edges of the capital, they say they've been edged out by politics. This referendum was, they say, their only chance to stick two fingers up to successive governments who've ignored them. And so they took it.
It's not the London effect, like, it's the haves and the have-nots, you know? And I think people have got the hump of it. I think that's one of the reasons why, like, so many people were voted out, because it is the haves and the have-nots.
That it wasn't necessarily about Europe and Europe.
I think it's a bit of everything, like, and everything just come together, like, and people have just finally got the hump and says, like, you know, right, we've had enough of this, you know, and we want out.
Four decades ago and everything looked and sounded very different.
It will be a splendid and decisive yes for Britain in Europe, for your generation and the whole of the next one.
David's 82-year-old father, Harry, was convinced.
We voted to come in for trade, to help businesses, small businesses, big business. That's what we voted for. But after a little while, that's what they strangled us. They put a root loop around our necks and started to tighten it up. I couldn't care less if I was skint and had no money, as long as I know I had my independence and my country and my queen and country still belong to me.
What does that actually mean, Harry?
It means, if you don't know what that means, you're missing out on something. You are definitely missing out on something. I spent two years in the army, and I swore allegiance to the king and country when I was in. When that flag went up and I saluted and I stood to attention, I thought that was a wonderful thing.
His sense of Englishness, polling suggests many who voted Leave share it, has clearly felt threatened by immigration, a problem crystallised in Gordon Brown's disastrous meeting with Gillian Duffy in the run-up to the last election.
You can't say anything about the immigrants because you're saying that but all these Eastern Europeans what are coming in, where are they flocking from?
The Crosbys say they too are fed up with politicians failing to understand their concerns.
You've got another 4 or 5 country who wants to join within the next 10 years.
The Turks in Billingsgate are terrible.
It was
but
an
if you don't want the
campaign.
Turks, that's quite racist. Say
you're all wrong.
If you say a whole race, they're not going to
be wrong. When you say I'm racist, I'm not racist. Racist is colour. I'm not racist against colour. I'm racist against the people that take and not give. Now, if you have the Turks here, all they'll do is drain us dry.
Older voters like Harry won the day. The vast majority of young people wanted to stay. 19-year-old George voted leave with his father and grandfather, but seems less certain of the outcome.
Now we're out of the EU, we can see if we can make it better. We can only try, I should say, really. We don't know what's going to happen, but I've got good faith that something good might happen.
So while he hopes for something good, those who voted to stay fear the worst. A country divided, a country about to change.
Jackie Long reporting from Romford. Well, joining us now to reflect on the vote and what it means for Britain is the novelist and commentator Will Self, who voted to stay in the EU, and the crime writer and journalist Drita Say Mitchell, who voted to leave. The two of them had pretty fiery debate on this programme on the eve of the vote. How do they feel now? Drita, you've got what you wanted, but what about what you really wanted?
Well, you know, everything will take time, and we have 2 years to work through this. And it's about all the political parties coming together and working with the EU to make the best exit for Britain. And I think one of the big things for me that I had wanted was all those voices in Britain, particularly outside of London, who weren't being heard about their concerns. And I think their concerns have been heard now.
Well, did the elite misunderstand the degree of alienation in the country?
Yeah, I mean, not to say I kind of told you so, but I started to call it this way a few weeks ago. I could see that the pollsters were not getting to tribal Labour, who nonetheless was powerfully anti-immigration and very, very uncomfortable with what they saw as the dilution of the British national character. And it's them what won it. They came out and they couldn't be reached by the pollsters. They couldn't be called by the markets. They don't understand these people. And Drita's right. This is the constituency that she's summoned up. But they're not the people she thinks they are. That's the problem.
What do you mean they're not the people?
They're
that
not
they
the
think
people. Oh, what's that up there in the sky? Is it a bird? Is it a plane? No, it's Boris Johnson come to deliver you social democracy in a more equal society.
But it's not. But, you know, people have seen this as a platform, finally, to get their voices heard. We live in a very complex, interconnected world. where people have just felt their voices are not being heard. And part and parcel of one of the issues has been the Labour Party have not been getting to their heartland. You've heard stories
of... So Boris is the key?
Boris, well, the Tories will do what they've got to do. So what we should be focusing on, I'm a Labour voter, is working with the Labour Party. Remember, we've got 2 years. That takes us up to 2018, 2019, then on the eve of 2020. And that's what we need to do, get back those votes to Labour so that we can do something in the next election.
You were just saying before we went live on air that this was not an ideological issue. You said it was to do with geopolitics. So you're happy...
I don't know what that means.
Well, you're happy about the fact that the Irish situation is under question now. You're happy about Scotland breaking the union. You're happy about Jeremy Corbyn having votes no confidence.
They've not broken the union.
And who is going to handle your defence in your brave, proud nationalist Britain?
The difference between me and
you
is... The difference between me and you at the moment in terms of tone is you seem very, very angry. I don't see feel
really
that kind
defeat.
Of yeah, but I don't feel like that. I feel like
so you don't feel, feel triumphal.
I don't feel
You've
angry.
Been doing the rounds
no,
studios,
I haven't.
You're not
I
in
haven't.
A state of
no, you're I'm cool. not actually. What so, I'm in a state of, if you read my Twitter, was the first thing I sent out this morning was now we have to work together. What people have to do is, regardless of what you think about the decision, this is where we are. Britain has got to come together. Politicians have got to come together to create some type of success for Britain.
So how
it's
are
as
you
simple
going
as that.
To...
I don't feel angry. I don't feel angry.
Why
I
would
feel
you feel angry? You're victorious.
I don't feel victorious.
You should have an understanding for the people who feel that their lives are shattered this morning. You should have an understanding for people, for the people from Eastern Europe who are in this country,
but
who
are
settled here.
You are very angry.
Because I think that this is a highly disruptive and, frankly, wrong-headed and stupid thing to do.
It's called democracy, Will. That's what it's called. It's called democracy.
Democracy
the people have voted,
the democracy
Will.
In this
the people
place,
have voted, Will.
What
it's
do you
called
feel
democracy.
About electoral reform, Drita? Do you think that the first-past-the-post system delivers a democratic and sovereign government?
At the moment, this is the democracy that we're in. You're very, very angry,
respect,
and I think we need
to
move on from the anger.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Anger.
I'm sorry for being angry.
I want to ask you something
angry.
About democracy,
okay.
because we're
yeah.
standing in front of the
Absolutely.
Mother of Parliaments.
Yeah.
That is an elective democracy.
Yeah.
That takes decisions for us. Introduced to save some party division in the Conservative Party was a referendum. A referendum, really, the way... Why wouldn't you leave it to the people
yeah,
you really
want?
Yeah,
we have a representative
want?
Democracy.
Hang on,
why don't
a minute,
you leave,
John's
why don't you leave
the
it to the MPs
yeah.
that you actually say,
well,
do are the people you want to represent you?
Well, that's what people want. They want the people who are their representatives.
Right, so they should
to,
have decided.
To do it, really. At the end of the day, the Prime Minister, David Cameron, called this, so the people
so
didn't have a choice.
So why did he call it, Drita?
I think you have to talk to David Cameron.
I know why he called it,
that.
And so do you. He called it as
I
a tactical
don't,
measure.
I don't know David Cameron.
Oh,
I've never met
sake.
Him. I don't know why he would have called
yeah,
it.
Yeah, the irony of all of this is that the Tories have been hoisted by the petard of unforeseen consequences, just the way Labour were over Scots.
It's interesting. When we had this debate the last time, people were calling this debate Drita versus the patriarchal finger pointer, because that's what you keep doing, is just pointing at me, and it feels very, very angry.
Well,
and you but, might feel angry, but I think we need to shift and move. If we're going to make a success of where we are now in Britain, we need to move on.
You should be a little bit more understanding of how people might feel
I understand,
today.
But
right,
we need
to move
on. Try
and be a little bit more conciliating. Say, what
I
have
think
you got
I am
to
being
say,
conciliatory.
What have you got to say to people, like these people from Eastern Europe or other places in the European Union, who now feel many, many hundreds of thousands, if not millions of them, that their whole livelihood and way of living has been disrupted today. What are you saying to the French people who've had 12% wiped off the bourse today?
Briefly, as I understand it, people who are here now, they can stay here now. I've heard that from people. I've heard that from
you're
people
sure that's
within
happen,
my
are you?
From within my family. What we need is we need people to come together to make this
that's
work.
That division remains, Will, I fear. Mm. But thank you both very warmly, Will Self, Drita Say Mitchell. Thank you very much for coming in. Joined now again by our political editor, Gary Gibbon. Your final thoughts, Gary, particularly on those who voted leave?
Well, it's fascinating. You look into the data and you see something of what you see when you look at supporters of Donald Trump in America. Extraordinary sort of culture wars going on as well, which is also such an American thing. 80% of them are very concerned about immigration. You kind of expect that. Mirror image of the Remain people. But you dig down and you discover that 80% of them think feminism or the Green movement are a force for bad. Extraordinary, absolute mirror image again of the people on the other side. But the key thing here is the focus on immigration. They think they voted for something very, very substantial in a change of policy on immigration, and it's going to be very, very hard for whoever replaces David Cameron to truly deliver on that. And if he doesn't, or she doesn't, then where do those voters go?
Gary Gibbon. So, the end of Britain's membership of the European Union and the end of David Cameron's political career. We leave you with some of his most memorable moments, set to music from his favourite bands. That's Channel 4 News. Good evening. Coming out of my
cage and I've been doing just fine. I'm standing here today to lead the Conservative Party to victory at the next general election.
He can turn any disaster into a triumph. That's one of the great things about Boris, and I'm very lucky to have him in my party.
I mean, UKIP, I mean, it's just a sort of, you know, bunch of fruitcakes and loonies and closet racists, basically.
Absolutely marvellous.
The people of Scotland have spoken. I was looking for a job and then I found a job. But I think this is the sweetest victory of all.
It will be an in-out referendum. Why do I give valuable time? Think of your grandchildren.
I love this country and I feel honoured to have served it.
Good evening. The weather's looking pretty mixed this weekend, with low pressure never too far away. That means it's a mixture of sunshine and heavy showers on Saturday. And then for Sunday, it's sunshine in the morning for most of us, but rain will arrive a little bit later in the day. Now, through this evening and overnight, still some showers around across northern and western parts of the UK. The odd one could be heavy, but the further east you go, the drier it will be across England. Clear spells there tonight. And quite a fresh night, temperatures widely dropping down in the range of 9 to 12 degrees. So tomorrow then, Saturday, part one of the weekend. For many of us, it starts on a dry note with some sunshine. But notice the dark blobs of blue blossoming to life through the day. There will be some fairly heavy thundery downpours developing, particularly across Scotland, down into central and eastern parts of England. But for the afternoon hours, much of Northern Ireland, Wales and southwest England should be dry, with a mixture of clouds and sunshine. Here's the picture then in more detail. This is 4 in the afternoon. And at this stage of the day, across the Channel Islands, along with Wales and southwestern parts of England, it's mainly dry. There'll be good spells of sunshine there. But for the rest of England, notice the dark blobs of blue scattered across the map. There will be some heavy thundery downpours of rain.